Welcome to the Nature Here TV show. Today we have with us Dr. Peter Lent, a wildlife ecologist and also the author of Muskoxen and Their Hunters. Dr. Lent, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Well, thanks, Heather. The last time we were here together, I was talking about black rhinos in South Africa, and I'm still involved in studies working with rhinos in South Africa. In fact, I'm off in March to visit them again. But in my youth, I spent most of my time as a biologist in Alaska. And this book, Muskoxen and Their Hunters, is a result of work mostly I did back in the 70s, but it didn't come out until the year 2000 when I had the time to finish it up. So what we're hearing today is about muskoxen from my work I did in my earlier part of my career.
When did you decide writing a book was something that you really wanted to do?
Well, I decided I wanted to write it about 1970 or so, but it wasn't until about 25 years later that I had time to really start it. And this book is available, by the way, through Amazon.com. There is a copy in the Multnomah County system and in Portland State University. It's a fairly academic book, but people with interest, especially in the Arctic and Arctic exploration and history, as well as the biology of the muskoxen, I hope would find it of interest.
Good. So they can pick it up locally, also order it online, and it's in the library.
Yes, that's correct. Yep.
Great. Okay, we're going to be watching a film that you have prepared for us.
That's right. We'll see film footage that I took back mostly in the early 1970s. This was 16 millimeter cine film, not what you're used to today. And of course, I was working on Nunivak Island for other reasons. And so filming was not my primary responsibility, but I did manage to get some pretty unique footage of muskoxen. And after the film, we'll talk more about where these muskoxen came from, how they got to Nunivak Island, which is a long and very interesting story, and about the conservation success story that is not well known.
Okay, so this film is going to be based in the 70s. That's when it was filmed?
Yes.
Okay, great.
And I forgot to mention that this film does have a soundtrack on it, but I'm going to give you my up-to-date version of what's on the film as we go along. And this is Nunivak Island. You can see the cliffs here. The island is about 75 miles long and separated from the mainland of Alaska by about 25 miles. These cliffs, on part of the coast of the island, are inhabited in summer by literally millions of cliff-dwelling birds. These are horned puffins. There are guillemots. There are murres, gulls, and many other species that come here to nest on these isolated and inaccessible cliffs. And of course, one of the reasons why birds nest on cliffs is to escape predators. And on Nunivak, we'll see in a moment, there's just one small predator. There are, of course, avian predators that will get a hold of eggs and young chicks if they can. But this is the largest native mammal on the island at present, a red fox. And this is the same species of red fox that you find here in Oregon or anywhere throughout the 48 states. And now, in fact, it's spread its range up to the farthest northern part of Alaska. Now, at one time, there were larger native mammals on Nunivak Island. There were caribou and even wolves at one time, but these have quite some time ago, possibly in the early part of the 20th century, were exterminated by hunters and others. And of course, these animals like red fox probably got to Nunivak Island by crossing over on the ice. Now, here we have domestic reindeer, at least they were domestic reindeer brought from Siberia, introduced in many parts of Alaska to help native people and to develop a agricultural industry. On Nunivak now, they run free year-round, and then they're harvested or rounded up for a harvest possibly once a year. What you see in there, you see those animals with very unusual coloration, like white coloration. That's how you can tell they're not wild caribou, but actually domestic reindeer. And here we see our muskoxen mixing in with the reindeer, the two species on the island, both introduced to the island by man, are quite tolerant of one another. Despite a lot of time there, I never saw any aggression. I never saw a muskoxen chasing a reindeer. And occasionally they bed down together, as we see here. Now these footage was taken, I was visited several times in the early 1970s. This footage is all taken in the month of August. Now one of the things that the muskoxen do that reindeer will never do is they go out on these steep slopes above the bird cliffs, extremely steep. You can hear, you see here, you wouldn't think an animal like a muskoxen would have the agility to go out there. And apparently they like this because the vegetation is well fertilized by all those birds flying over. And so occasionally we've found muskoxen that have fallen off these steep slopes and died falling off down below onto the rocks below. Now in late August, the rutting or breeding season starts. This is a big male and he's horning in the ground. This is part of the rutting behavior. Also, you'll notice these flappy pieces of white fur or wool coming out of him. This is the underwool of the muskox. We'll talk more about that later. It's generally known by the Eskimo or Inuit name of kiviut. Actually begins Q-I-V-I-U-T, one of the few words, the Q that isn't followed by a U. Anyhow, this is a horning pit left by a bull muskoxen. Quite understand why they do this. It may be olfactory marking because they rub their foreheads in there, and they do have glands in front of the eyes called the preorbital glands. Now we see two bulls. This is basically a contest beginning. There they clash their horns, and then they go into a dominance display. They're displaying to each other laterally, and that big hump over the four quarters seems to make a male muskoxen look bigger, giving him a feeling of dominance over the other one. Look how he's sidestepping into the towards the one as he goes, moving laterally and showing off.
Do they all do that?
All the bulls during this time of year. Other times of year you would probably never see it.
But season,
yeah, there's a breeding season which goes on for about 2 months of the year at most, starting in August, going into September. So this is late summer. And I didn't mention it, but this is not an Arctic island. It's more of a maritime island, northern maritime, not the true Arctic. So here again, you see this male is displaying to the other male. He's kind of circling around in an arc, moving in closer, always keeping his side. And you see how his horns, his head is sort of tilted to the other male. See me, I've got big horns. I've got a big front quarter. You don't want to fool with me. So it's all part of a dominance display.
I like how he kind of goes in real slow.
Yeah,
and
moves
easy.
In slow,
he's not,
right.
He's not
slowly
gonna, like,
getting
jump into
closer.
It. He's going to take his
right.
time.
And most of the encounters between males is like that. And here, well, one male is deciding, yeah, he wants to move away. He doesn't want to fool this other guy. Okay, so here we have males also. You can see how the horns come together and what we call the boss. They come together, whereas in the females, you'll see there's a patch of white hair there. So these are two males kind of fooling around, thinking about whether they're going to get serious about this. There's a lot of just testing of each other.
Now, are there females in the vicinity and they're just like, they're just trying to get their ground on where
the females,
where
the females are around. We'll see them in a while. But again, you see those funny white stripes of kiviut, the underwool coming out on the rear of that one, for example, and then up on his four quarters. By now, the females have lost all that. They've shed that wool. It's just something like your dog sheds wool in the summer, getting ready for winter. Sheep used to do that before we, and the hairs that's remaining there are called the guard hairs, those long hairs
Did they ever lose all of that? Or does a little bit still stick around?
Yeah, a little bit sticks around, but by winter they'll have a new coat of underwool underneath them. Okay, now this is a real charge here. Coming up, there's the other one way over there, like knights jousting.
Oh wow.
And the sound of that, unfortunately, I never recorded, but I can tell you it can be heard a half a mile away over. It's a booming sound. So they have this whole special structure in their skull, those horns, to make it so they can do that. So these two, well, you know, it's not always clear who won and who lost, but eventually it seems like one says, oh, well, I've had enough of this, I'm moving away. And eventually we'll see, to the victor goes the spoils. They try to hold together a harem, a small number of females, and keep other males away. But sometimes if it's a young male, they're quite tolerant and allow a young male to hang around close to the harem if he behaves himself.
Right.
Right. And here's a couple of younger ones just fooling around, testing their skills, getting ready for the big moment if it comes. Here again, a little bit of displaying, tilting the head towards the other one on the right. Sometimes you get groups of males that have been excluded, but they're out there practicing. Okay, now this is a group of, you see the harem male there in the background lying down, a somewhat younger male in the foreground, and he's tolerated as long as he's just taking it easy, and a female off there to the left in the background, and young calves. And of course, females only have a single calf in a year. Sometimes they even skip a year if conditions are very poor, but on Nunivak, where the conditions are generally pretty good, they often produce a calf. They usually produce a calf every year. This male is, so the males, once they have a group of females, they're constantly testing the females, if you like, to see who might be in estrus, ready to mate.
So the one in the middle there, is that the, was that the male or the
yeah,
female?
I think you saw the male.
Okay.
And here's a male. You can see again the big hump there. You can tell him the big hump over the forequarters, the kiviute hanging on. He's testing a female here at her rear, probably olfactory testing, and also to see whether she's ready. There's a few reindeer going by in the background minding their own business. Here again, testing the female. See, the female looks very clean. And also, they all have this white saddle. You can see it there very distinctly on that female. Not quite sure what that white saddle, what role it has in their behavior. So she's not quite ready, and she's going to keep him waiting a while. And there you see, okay. Here again, the males seem to, in some species, the males would be chasing the calves away. This female still has her calf, born in April, so it's probably about 5 or 6 months old there, and the male he tolerates the calf. He's just interested in the calf's mother.
So how long does the calf stay around before they actually kind of...
Yeah, this is about the time that they start. The females will see, I think here in a moment, a scene where, okay, this is more of a male testing the female. And if you might have noticed, he started to raise his foreleg there as if he was going to mount, but she's a moving target. And this just shows you how a male there in the background with a harem sort of spread out, a couple of young ones out there. Here's the young one, yeah, who's still nursing. And this female seems to be tolerating it still. Again, this would be about the end of August, and that calf was probably born in April. And there's the male, a harem male on the left. And she finally has enough of this nursing attempt. She kind of discourages the calf and moves away, but she doesn't really get too aggressive. Later on, she may actually butt it to,
as it gets a little older.
Yeah, so it gets the message, and I suppose it's getting a little more painful or whatever. And she's producing less milk, and she's already going to want to be ready to start putting energy into producing another calf to be born the following April.
So can they have a calf every year?
Usually they do, if the conditions are good. Originally, explorers in the very, very northern part of the Arctic claimed that they only had a calf every other year. But now we know it's more or less a case of nutrition and conditions. Well, that was a calf rubbing itself on a rock. Found a rock out there in the tundra. And this is a village on the island which is now deserted, a village called Nash Harbor. It was a place where we had very good forage for animals and often used as a base for both hunters and for our efforts to capture muskoxen, which we'll see more about in the slides I'm going to show after. So that's an abandoned Eskimo village now. And you can see looking off down the island. And of course, at that time especially, the sea ice came in and surrounded the island of Nunivak in the winter. Now, with the changing conditions, that doesn't happen so much. But here we now move to April on the island, and this on one part of the island, in addition to the sea cliffs, they have a whole series of sand dunes, high sand dunes, which is very unusual. There's only one or two other cases known this far north. And these sand dunes are very preferred winter forage, winter range for the muskoxen, because there's a very heavy grass growth on them, and also because the tops of the dunes are exposed to the wind, which are extreme here during the winter. That blows the snow off the tops of the dunes, and then as you get into like late April, the sun's effect is also melting the snow away. So there's intensive use of these dunes at this time in late winter. The snowfall on Nunivak Island is much greater than in the true Arctic. That's always a fact you have to keep telling people. The high Arctic, as we call it, the far north, is generally more like a desert. It receives very low snowfall. But what happens throughout the Arctic is that because of the wind effect, the snow is redistributed. So here, the tops of the dunes are bare. Muskoxen are using them not just for feeding, but as corridors for travel, like you see here. And this group is also interesting because there are three bulls traveling together, and there's a calf that has either lost its mother or been separated from its mother. And again, these bulls, they have a herd instinct, social instinct, and they're here, as you can see, they're totally tolerant of this calf. Okay.
So they'll take him in.
They'll let him hang around. They're not going out of their way to
help
take care of him, but he can hang around. He's okay. Or she, I don't know. Hard to sex them, the young ones.
Do they usually stay in herds of like three, or do they go bigger than that?
Often bigger. We're going to see in a few minutes here the other extreme, a group of about 70 or more, but this would be a fairly small group. Males, for whatever reason, they've isolated themselves from the cows, and also they're not the most mature, they're not the biggest males. So. Here again, you can see them feeding on the dunes. major part of their winter forage. You can see there a little bit of remains of a snowdrift there, and that animal's actually sort of wading through it. In fact, muskoxen are not really good at digging through deep snow. And that was one of their problems on Nunivak Island. When they put them there back in the 30s, we'll talk more about that later, they never realized how important it was that muskoxen have winter range with very shallow snow. Now here again, as I said, they concentrate the numbers on these dunes, and they're causing quite a bit of damage. Look at how this has all been eroded away. This is my Inuit companion who was from the village of Makoryuk, who was accompanying me, and that just to show the scale of how this erosion was occurring. So we were convinced that there were too many muskoxen on the island at this time, and that they needed to be moved off the island, or some people wanted to open it up to hunting. I'll talk more about that after the film footage finishes. So here again, example of damage to the dunes. Okay, now we move over to the west end of the island, where another area where muskoxen concentrate in the wintertime. And here we see a very large group. But this large group was created because of our disturbance. In other words, we were using snow machines. We approached, we got a little too close before we went out on foot, and that caused them to come together, and they're disturbed. You see in the center there, a really big male. You can see him kind of standing out.
He looks like he's watching you, like
he's
watching
me.
I know you're there.
Right, and the others are all pretty alert here. And so they've come together, and I think there were over 70 in this group.
Wow.
So, but they were there because they were feeding in another type of winter habitat. I'll see a little better. Very sparse vegetation. So what I was trying to do here was document how they came together in disturbance. And then I was just crouching quietly with my camera on a tripod and waiting to see what happened, how these big group that had taken this defensive formation, how they slowly got, oh, well, we got to start feeding again or whatever.
And he's not causing any harm.
Yeah. So here's like a group drifting off, separating themselves from that big, big mass, and then they start feeding a bit. But you can see this is very sparse, rocky vegetation. It was amazing how many animals could actually forage and get food off this.
There's not much there, and there's a lot of them.
Not much there, yep. But again, because this end of the island, because it's somewhat exposed, it got very strong wind in the winter, and that's why they could find the food. The muskoxen do not dig through deep snow. Caribou, for example, will dig through more than a foot of snow to get at forage in the wintertime, but muskoxen almost never do that. So they need these areas where either the wind-blown effect opens up forage, or they need to be in areas where there's very little snowfall. So gradually they're going around about their business. A couple of them are still glancing over in my direction. So I didn't mention it before, but if you notice the females, they have on their forehead a white patch, a patch of white hair at exactly the same area where the males, like that one on the left there, have the horns, the horn boss comes together. So the white patch of hair sort of simulates horns. And this is all playing some role in their social behavior. But of course, the horns, the males, especially these large males, but even the females, also plays a very important role in their defense against predators. And in modern times, that's been primarily the wolf, but also in certain areas, especially more recently, polar bears. Because polar bears, because of the changing of climate change, warming of the Arctic, polar bears are spending more and more time on land. And if they're on land, they're looking for prey. So there have been several cases recently of polar bears killing muskoxen. Not what you'd expect.
No, I wouldn't think so. You'd think it'd be the other way around because they seem so aggressive and fierce.
Well, yeah. But again, the defensive formation of muskoxen is really very effective against wolves and could be effective against dogs, but hunters with dogs also have no problem if they're armed with modern weapons in killing muskoxen. So here animals are starting to feed again. And obviously they cannot stay all that time in a very dense group. They need to spread out in order to find food so they're not competing closely with each other. Now, another reason why they separate is the cows want to separate a bit if they have very young calves. And this is a group of females that has moved off. When one gives birth, I've seen this in captive muskoxen, it attracts other females. They come over and they actually watch her giving birth and they stay very close to her. It's like they take a big interest in it. And that's probably what happened here. We have two females that have given birth to calves within the last day or two. You'll see them in a moment. And a couple of other females that are hanging out with them. There's the first little calf there, showing itself, this little black object. Probably just a bit over a day old, yeah. So this is the youngest one I ever was able to see in the wild.
Do they go a little further out from the group to give birth, just to kind of, for safety reason?
Yes, I think it's safety in terms of accidental being stepped on, I suppose. Even in captivity, I've noticed that females do always move off on their own to give birth, but then they attract other females. Could also be that, here's one looking at its baby there, but it could be, in some cases, you'll see the other female just come up and take an interest in a newborn calf, and that doesn't seem to bother the mother too much. Here you see it smelling at the rear end. That's typical. Check out the smell, see if that's really my calf or somebody else's. Don't want to get confused here.
Do they come out and walk fairly quickly like that?
Pretty quickly, yes. Okay. Yes, they'll be walking. They probably nurse within the first time for an hour or two, within 2 hours after they're born. So, and you'll see in a moment that these calves are old enough that they know exactly how to nurse. And of course, it's a little complicated. There's all this hair hanging down, and they have to find their way through that to the right spot. And the wind is often blowing, like here. And there you can see one, and the wind is really blowing.
Yeah, it is really. How cold is it on?
This was not terribly cold. This was right around freezing or a little bit below. So again, but it was kind of a nasty wind nevertheless. And so they need to spend a lot of time in the shelter of the mother so that they don't, or the other females maybe, so there's not too much heat loss. And so this two calves bring it sort of to the end of the cycle, at the end of April. And calves are born. Soon summer will be coming again. And we'll be back into the annual cycle of muskoxen on Nunivak Island. You can see out there the sea ice with some open water. And so again, stressing these muskoxen are only on Nunivak Island because humans put them there. Wasn't a good choice, but it did work out pretty well in the end. The muskoxen numbers over many years built up to over 700 on the island when this footage was taken.
That's a lot. Is that baby nursing? Is that
yes, what he's doing? The baby is definitely nursing there. And you can tell, like I said, that by this age, it's figured out how to do it pretty well and figured out
so
who's mom.
That is a great video. That was some really good footage. Interesting, for sure.
Thank you. Today, I want to talk more about how muskoxen got to this island. And by the way, we didn't really show this picture at the beginning, but here, this map, you can see where Nunivak Island is in relation to Alaska, to the mainland of Alaska. So now you have a better feeling. We'll show a couple more maps as we go along.
How big is that island?
Yeah, it's about 75 miles across, and it's about a 25-mile strait separating it from the mainland.
Okay.
So here we have a map of the world looking down from the North Pole. If you see those two lines there crossing at the center, that's where the North Pole is. You're not used to looking at maps of this projection, and you see in the very upper part is Alaska. Circling around to the left, you'll see Canada. You see a dashed line there in northern Canada. That area of the islands is where muskoxen remained. They were never exterminated from that area. Extending over down, you'll see Greenland in the lower right, and you'll see also along the east coast of Greenland an area there with a dashed line, and that's where the muskoxen that got to Nunivak came from. Then you see over there, you'll see Norway, where they were also reintroduced, and then up at the upper left, a couple of locations where they were reintroduced to Siberia, and we're going to talk about that now. But the first move was from East Greenland off, captured there, spent a winter in Norway in captivity, put on boats, and taken across to New York City. New York City, they went by railroad across to Seattle, put on boats again, taken up to Alaska. From there, they went by railroad again up to Fairbanks. This was back in 1930s. An amazing feat.
That's quite a trip.
Yeah, quite a trip. No mortality. They all survived. And this was a congressionally funded program, believe it or not. The idea was to reintroduce muskoxen to Alaska as a domestic species. Okay. And so here's a scene from the capture of muskoxen on East Greenland. These were Norwegian sealers, and they captured them, unfortunately. They got these calves alive. Unfortunately, in most cases, they killed the mother in order to do it. They had done this before because there was a big market for them in zoos in Europe and whatever. But they captured the ones that went to Alaska. Okay, this one, I wanted to show this. It's out of place here a little bit, but if you can see the size, relative size of the muskox there, the second one on the right. This is a drawing from my book, drawn by my wife, Leslie. And you can see the bison is quite a bit bigger. In fact, if you look at the weight of a bull bison, it can go up to 2,000 pounds, whereas the biggest male muskox go about to 800. And then you see a caribou there, a reindeer to the left, a wolf, a prehistoric lion, and finally an Inuit hunter.
They look so much bigger than you think that they are.
Well, they have a lot of hair on them. Okay, back to this trip. This is what the muskoxen looked like. I think they'd been in Fairbanks at the University of Alaska for a year or two. You can see they're older now, and this man has developed a very safe way of going in with the muskoxen.
Is he moving that?
Yeah, he's moving that to a movable fence. And he's,
nice.
But things didn't work out too there. As we know, the same sort of stories back in the 1930s. The funding for the project ran out. And also, they'd had some problems in Fairbanks. A couple of muskoxen were actually killed by black bears. So they decided they had to do something else. And they took them from Fairbanks, you see there, in 1935 and 1936. They took them down to this Nunivak Island, where we've seen the movies of them. And then from there, Nunivak has been the basis for all the other translocations to many different locations around the world. First of all, as you can see in the 69 and 70, they took them back to the Arctic part of Alaska where muskoxen had originally occurred. Some were brought back to Fairbanks for a domestication project, and then they later moved on from there to different locations. And eventually some, as you can see, were taken to two locations in Siberia, as well as also some back to Nome in the Seward Peninsula in Alaska. So here's one of the arrivals at Nunivak Island. This one didn't seem to want to go explore her new home. She was reluctant to get out of the crate and go ashore. And in the background, you see this in this archival photo, an Inuit Eskimo in a true traditional kayak. Now, one of the other locations where muskoxen have been introduced is the mountains of Norway, and they've done pretty well there. There's a beautiful national park in Norway called Dovrefjell. And if you're ever in Norway, there are tours where you can go and see them. One of their problems there, though, have been with just too many people harassing them, lots of tourists. But there's still a small population there, and a few have even moved on to Sweden on their own. They emigrated to Sweden. This is another scene of the in the mountains of Dovrefjell, Norway. Now I move to West Greenland, where I also had a wonderful opportunity to visit muskoxen and spend some time in Greenland. This is also an introduced population because there's a big area there in West Greenland where muskoxen could never get there on their own because of the ice cap that covers most of Greenland. There was no way around it to get there. So the Greenland, the Danish government, introduced them to this beautiful area. And this is, by the way, one of the few areas where you can actually see beautiful fall colors in the tundra.
I was going to say that, the landscaping there
is amazing. That is really an amazing landscape. I've visited tundra in a lot of other areas, but never anything as colorful as this. There's another scene of it, just beautiful reds from low willows and birches. And surprise, another big surprise in the tundra of Greenland, you get these Arctic hares. They just stand out like, wow, where'd that come from?
Just checking it out.
Yeah, just checking it out, all white. And apparently they stay white all year round because they don't have to worry much about predation. So what's the point of changing color? And that's just a scene of showing this area called Kongerluswak. Is the name of this valley, and you see in the background the ice cap that covers most of Greenland. Of course, this was taken a few years ago, and I assume that ice cap has now receded due to global warming. And another scene of muskox feeding right up at the edge where the snow is melting, and there's new forage, new growth, and good feeding. Okay, another scene from Greenland. This is in the capital of Greenland, which is now called Nuuk. This is kind of the Greenland equivalent of a farmer's market. The municipality has an area where people, hunters and trappers, can come and sell fresh meat to the residents of the town. In this case, they had muskox meat, caribou meat, and seal meat. You could take your choice there.
Is muskox meat, is it pretty common?
It's pretty good to eat, yeah. Okay. I've had it once. There's a lot of hunting for it. And the name muskox, of course, I should have talked about. It does have a musky smell during the bulls do during the rutting season. But most times of year, the meat is quite good. Okay, speaking of big male muskoxen, so this is back on Nunivak Island now. As I said, this was a place where the animals were in great abundance. We wanted to move them off to other areas, and these were some big bulls that were immobilized and moving them off to the Arctic part of wildlife, the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge in northern part of Alaska, northeastern corner. But in this case, they needed to transport these big bulls because they were necessary to help form defensive formations when the muskoxen were released in their new home, because that was an area where there are wolves.
So are they tranquilized there?
Yeah, they're tranquilized. Drugs were used in this case, clearly. But these are big, big, big bulls.
Yeah, probably. They look big.
They're between 600 and 800 pounds.
Oh, wow.
So, and those are the crates in the background that they went on their way in to Barter Island in the northeastern corner of Alaska. So yeah, there you can see it again. That's that line going up to Barter Island, which is an old dew line radar military base on an island just off from the Arctic National, what's now called the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge in Alaska.
And how long of a trip was that?
Yeah, I don't know, probably an hour or so. Not too long.
Oh, so it's not too long.
2 hours, yeah, maybe 2 hours, yeah. And now we're going to talk about a little bit also about the translocation to the Soviet Union, which I was heavily involved in. And here we see that. This is a scene of capturing muskoxen to go to Siberia, sending them off to Siberia. In this case, the Russians wanted as many animals as they could fit in their cargo plane, so we went for the smaller ones. In this case, they decided no drugs were going to be used, and instead, the Eskimos on Nunivak Island made these big nets. We went after the animals with fast-moving snow machines under good conditions, and they could just throw the nets over the animals, wrestle them down, and get them into a crate.
So they went in the crate not tranquilized either?
No tranquilos, the whole thing, all the way off to Siberia even.
Wow.
Yeah, and this is a film crew filming there. Those of you older among the viewers may remember the program Wild Kingdom with Marlon Perkins for years and years back in the 70s. Maybe it was probably the key wildlife program on national TV in the US. So he came out to film this. And here are the muskoxen we caught. When we got them back in these fenced areas that had been put up, the fence had been put up there in the summer anticipating this. As you can see, all these young muskoxen just beautifully formed a defensive formation, no training needed. And that was good because we were worried they were going to jump over the fence.
Spread out. And then
because there had been a lot of snow drifting in there, and we didn't want them to jump. But as long as they were together like this, they felt safe.
Instinct
kicked in.
Nice.
Yeah. And oh, here, this is scene. This is where we are, trying to dig a trench out so they couldn't jump over. That man there with the dark suit and the sunglasses was the chief Russian biologist on this mission, Sava Mikhailovich Uspensky. And what happened at the time, though, this is a whole thing that Nixon had set up, a detente with the Soviet Union, big government operation. But what happened was we had a group in Alaska get a court injunction to stop the muskoxen from going to the Soviet Union. It was my job to try to explain this to these Russian biologists, how this could happen. Only in the U.S., eh? And this is a cartoon from the Anchorage paper, U.S. government aircraft taking muskoxen off to the USSR, and some people argued that this was actually state property, the state of Alaska, blah, 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 on and on, to Russia with love, it says.
With the peace symbol off the back. There's a lot going on in that
right,
picture. Definitely is a lot
it's
to
a
say.
It's a fun cartoon. But in the meantime, we had a lot going on, and it was my job when we got these to the town of Bethel, where we were going to put them on an aircraft for the bigger flight back to the bigger airport to get them back to the Soviet Union. We had to find something to do with them until the court injunction was lifted. So we had to find a warehouse to release 44 muskoxen in. And here we are when the court injunction was finally lifted, trying to get these muskoxen back into their crates.
And those 44 were not tranquilized either?
No.
That just seems crazy.
That's me there on the left in my younger day, trying to hog wrestle a muskoxen and get it back in its crate. And there's a Soviet plane where we finally got them loaded on their way to Siberia, and they've done pretty well there. So this was the first Russian plane to land in Alaska since World War II. So it was quite an event. But it was very successful. One animal, the 44, did die. It was a young female that was pregnant, and we had, at that time, very little expectation that such a young animal would be pregnant. So there again, you see where they went from, Nunivak Island, and just across the mainland is the town of Bethel, where there was a big airstrip where we could use as a point for getting them off to the Soviet Union. Okay, in addition, I mentioned there is a domestication project that's been started. And this is moved around a bit, but it's now in the town of Palmer, Alaska, and they are domesticated, although this is a tourist attraction. You can visit it if you're in, it's quite near Anchorage if you're up there. It's worth a visit, close to Anchorage. But the main reason for this tourist, for this domestication project was not meat, not tourism, but to harvest this kiviut, this underwool that I talked about in the film. And here's a woman who has a muskoxen in a press in a small area, and she's actually combing the wool out of this muskoxen and collecting it, putting it in that plastic bag behind her. Then this wool is sent off somewhere to be processed. It's extremely fine wool, finer than finer than the finest cashmere.
Do they sit for that fairly well? I mean,
It's sometimes a little trouble, but most of it, again, it's all done without drugs. Animals have been trained to go through this routine. And so what this is used for, the whole purpose of this, was to a village industry to send this yarn made from kiviut off to Eskimo Inuit villages. And here's a woman in a village knitting a garment for sale. It's then sent back to Anchorage, where there is a store where you can buy this. A little bit pricey. My wife Leslie has a nice little hat, though, of kiviut hat. And so you can get these items. And here's a picture made of some of the items made from kiviut.
It has a look of cashmere.
Yes, it does. Very fine, beautiful, lightweight cashmere. This is been a fairly successful effort to help Eskimo women in the villages. And maybe we can talk about the whole effort to domesticate a new species on a future program. And I think we just have, yeah. Okay, so, okay. Here's the last one I want to show, because I just got this slide to update it. This is from the Alaska Department of Fish and Game. Showing the areas in Alaska where muskoxen now naturally occur. You can see the Arctic part up there, a part coming down the northwest coast, including Nome and the Seward Peninsula, and then a smaller area, Nunivak Island, across from Nunivak Island. At present, the only hunting that's allowed in Alaska, well, there is some so-called subsistence hunting by native people, but the only so-called sport hunting for muskoxen that's allowed is on Nunivak Island itself. Okay.
Other than that, you can't sport hunt?
Not in Alaska, only on Nunivak Island. And there's drawings for that. And of course, usually people go out there and they have a local Eskimo guide from the village of Mokoryuk. So that at least whether you think hunting is a good thing or not, it helps control the population on the island and does contribute to the economy of that village.
Okay, so I have a few questions about it, just as kind of watching the videos and the slides and stuff.
Great.
I like the pictures. That's really amazing to see. And the older footage is unique because it just, you were that in there the whole time filming it.
Yeah, I was just. Yeah.
And how long did that footage take for you to do that? Was that?
Well, I don't know. I made several trips, probably 5 or 6 trips at least, and was out there for each one for a couple of weeks at a time, a week or two at a time. But doing other things, looking at the damage to the vegetation while I was there.
So doing a lot of different
filming
things.
Wasn't my major thing, but I did get a good understanding of muskox behavior in the wild. Actually, some of that is described in my book, and also I've published it in scientific papers.
So. Okay, and so the main thing between the two muskox for female and male is, it's the why we saw the white on the female.
Yeah.
But the females have horns, though, still, don't
they? They do have horns, but they don't have this big
growth
called the boss, where it comes slowly across the front of the face, actually fuses together in the male. But they do have horns, and those horns are sharp. And
still dangerous.
And there's a few cases where we know where wolves have been punctured by a horn and actually killed by muskoxen. So they're prey species, but it's not always a one-way battle.
Yeah. Right. And they seem to be oriented family-wise as far as like males and females. Like the females seem to like help each other out during birthing, and they kind of stay together, and the males tend to, is that pretty common for them to kind of, they get together and they mate and they kind of separate?
Sometimes there are male groups, but females also depend upon the large males in these defensive
for formations. For protection.
And for wolves and things. Those big males are sort of, as you saw in the one scene, the male, a big male is right there
in the
center,
middle saying,
kind of a key,
in control of this.
Key, yeah. And so the females do depend upon being with males to really have the most effective defense formation. Yeah.
And is there any particular animal that is more, that's more like a super dangerous to them? Obviously the polar bears, which I find is,
yeah,
I just, that seems strange to me.
That seems fascinating.
Yeah,
right.
Just
grizzly bears, and again in northeastern Alaska, there's now cases of where they know where grizzly bears have killed them. So in modern day, those would be the wolves and bears would be the only.
So obviously
predators,
a
yeah,
and animal.
Prehistoric times, Pleistocene, there were other animals, yeah.
And I was, as I'm watching it, you know, like you saw them running through the terrain and stuff like that, are they fairly fast? They just look so heavy and bulky, and the fur seems like so much. They don't look like they're very agile, but they climb the sides of the mountains, and they seem to be going fairly fast through the plains. I mean, are they?
They can move
pretty
fast.
Quick?
They
okay.
can move pretty fast, right. And there are a few cases where muskoxen have killed people. Especially a couple of cases I mentioned the problems in Norway, especially in Sweden, where you have big human populations near muskoxen that have gone wild. In a couple of cases, muskox bulls are known to have killed men who were teasing them. So, yeah.
So, because when you saw the two male bulls like going at each, I mean, they weren't slow. They were fast,
yes,
and fierce, and I would imagine when you were filming, I'm thinking to myself, if they were upset with it at some point, they could charge you for sure if they felt like that was the need.
Yeah, I didn't give them any reason to do that.
Yeah, right. I don't know, just being in their space to me, I'm thinking,
yeah.
Oh,
so
at some
in
point.
Most cases, like I say, the number of documented cases of people being killed by muskoxen is very, very few.
Small.
Certainly under 10, as far as I know, that have ever been recorded. Now, of course, the native people in Alaska, when they first had muskoxen there, you know, they had been exterminated for more than a century, and so they had no real direct knowledge of them, and people were very scared. Women said, no, we can't go out berry picking anymore because
well, they
it's
look
dangerous.
They're intimidating. I mean,
yeah.
I look at them, and
right.
I would be intimidated by one
right.
if I saw one.
But in actual fact, there's been
very few.
Almost no case of.
So anyone. Are they pretty docile? Like they don't, you don't mess with them,
yeah,
they don't mess with you.
That's
kind of thing?
About how you could sum it up.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah. Okay.
And
are they related to the sheep and goat kind of, I don't know, animal? They seem like they have the characteristic of it because you can take their fur and you can make things out of it, you know, like you can do with sheep. And
yeah, not as closely related as we thought. And they're called musk oxen, but they're certainly not oxen. And they're really not closely related to the sheep. It's very obscure. There's an animal in the Himalayas that they may be most closely related to. But most people don't realize that our sheep that we have now originally were like that. They had long guard hairs, and they had wool that had to be combed out to be used. Just that humans have bred sheep now that do not have those long guard hairs. And so the wool is all you see when you look at a domestic sheep.
Right. So this animal, how long has it like been around? Like, obviously, it's been around for a long time. It's like Ice Age. It looks like something out of, I don't know.
Well, sure, it's been around. But then lots of animals have been around since the Ice Age. Yeah, it's been around for a very long time. And
mostly in just the Alaskan area?
Well, we believe that at one time it spread all through the Arctic. I discussed this in my book quite a bit, that they once were fairly common in northern Russia, what we call Siberia, if you like, maybe even getting farther south into the mountains. But they were easily exterminated by human hunters, especially once human hunters had dogs. Because when you have dogs, then they stand in their defensive formation, and you can come up at close range and kill them with arrows or with or with guns. So once, when humans were hunting them, before they had domestic dogs, muskoxen were a real challenge. But once they got
it under control,
domestic dogs, then they could use domestic dogs for hunting.
Okay. And if somebody wanted to go and see one, or they wanted, like I said, so you said a few places they have like excursions or things that they can do, what's like a really common place or a...
Yeah, I think for wild ones, probably that area around Nome on the Seward Peninsula in Alaska, where you can get a tour out of there and you can get to Nome with a commercial scheduled flight. That might be one of the best areas. The domestication project near Anchorage is a great place. If you have the opportunity to go up into the Arctic National Wildlife Refuge, that's of course a wonderful place to visit, our biggest national wildlife refuge, but that requires a lot more expense and preparation
to get there. Closeness-wise.
Norway is another place. Greenland, not too many people will get to Greenland. So Norway, the mountains of Norway, that Dovrefjell National Park is a good place. If you're a tourist in Norway, I would recommend that. Yeah.
And are there large...
And also there is, the Russians took them to an island called Wrangel Island, which is actually just around, we don't have a map that shows it here. Yes, you see how that point of, on this map, you see where it says Chukchi Sea, and you go around there, it's just out of sight, around the corner, it's part of the Soviet Union, and there are now cruise ships that take people up through northern Alaska, up through the Bering Sea and the Chukchi Sea,
and they visit
Wrangel Island, and it's also a Russian National Park, Wrangel Island.
Right, and lots of them up there, or just?
I couldn't tell you how many, but I think there are a couple of hundred on that island. I think there are now currently at least 2,000 in Alaska, and about 500 of those are on Nunivak Island.
So enough where they would at least see.
Yeah, a good chance, right.
Great. Well, I really appreciate you coming today and talking about this, and I would definitely recommend your book for sure. I like that, you know, it's at the library and other places in case people, you know, just, you know, the readily availability of it. But I enjoyed talking with you, and thank you so much for taking your time out and talking with us about this.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you.